Good morning, my name's Don with Cedar Park Overhead Doors, and today we're going to talk about justice. And that justice would be, this morning we went out to the garage to press the button to open the garage door, nothing happened. So this is a problem that occurs in a lot of homes every year, and we want to show you what the effects are, how it happens, and how to, the best way to take care of that problem. So follow me, we're going to head out to the garage and take a look and see what's happening.
So when we look at the door, everything looks sort of normal. Your opener's hooked up, the everything's working there, everything looks good. You can hear the motor coming on, and yet the door still doesn't want to open. So let's look closely at the door and see the story that it's telling us. If I walk over here and I take a look at the door, we have a door lock that is not engaged right now. So that's not the problem. That's not why the door doesn't go up. Your opener motor is running, it's trying to lift the door up. And if we actually pan down and look down here on the door, you'll notice that this door is doing something unusual. It is actually kind of bending in. And if I look here, there's sunlight coming through the door. And on the edges, we have a pretty tight seal. So the door is actually bent in right now. And the reason is that the opener is trying to lift the door by dragging it towards the back of the garage, like it normally would, but the door's not moving. And the reason the door's not moving is on this door, a closer look up here would indicate that you have these two springs. There's one here, and there's one here, and their job is to lift the door so the opener has an easy movement. And if we look closely at the left-hand spring, we'll notice that that spring is broken in two. So that means that only one spring is lifting this door. And that's why the door's not moving when the opener's lifting. And right now there's a lot of tension on this door because the opener started up and then it stopped. When we put in an opener, we adjust the opener so it puts force on the door to move the door to be able to lift it, but we don't want too much force because if we had set it wrong or too tight, it would pull up this door, it would bend the door right in half. Or if by mistake someone had locked the door, it would go ahead and rip the door right off the wall. So we tune the door down so it doesn't pull as hard. The motor should not have to be lifting a door with one single spring. As a matter of fact, what I'm going to do here is I'm going to pull this rope down. Now when I pull this rope down, what that's gonna do is it's gonna release the tension here, and you should see this door snap back a little. There's a lot of force here. So I'm gonna bring the door down and watch what happens to the door. See how it jumps back to the wall. All the pressure that was on it to bring it back has now been released because this thing is no longer tight. Okay? So that's good, and it still means that this spring has to be replaced. Now this is where the dangerous part comes in. When you replace this spring still has tension on it. There's two springs, each one lifts, in this case, this door, somewhere around 80 pounds of weight. This is a 160-pound door. It's a very hard door for me to lift by myself, but I still have one spring up here that's gonna have to do this, to lift the door. So it is possible for me to lift the door. Now, when we replace springs with the door always has to be down. But there's a problem here. If we take a look, if you back up a little bit, you can see that there's vehicles in this garage right now. So we really want to get the vehicles out of the garage. So what we're going to do, and what you might do if you're stuck in the morning and you can't get your garage door out, is there's two things in the garage that are going to help lift this door up. One is me, and the other is the opener up on the ceiling. It still is willing to do a little work to help me lift the door up. So if there's a little caveat here I want to say. If you have a two-spring system, you still have this spring here, 80 pounds of lift to help you lift up this 160-pound door, okay? A lot of doors put in less expensive doors come with a single spring. If a single spring breaks, the door is stuck down. The drum, this drum over here on the end, and this bar, this torsion tube, will lose all tension, they'll roll backwards and the cables will come off. It's a lot harder to fix a door if that only has one spring system on it, especially when you want to get the cars out of the garage. Otherwise, we'd have to redo the springs with the cars in the garage, and I don't want them there. So what we're going to do now is we're going to re-secure the operator to the door, which it will do as soon as we hit the button over there, and I'm going to lift the door, and we're going to get the door up, and we're going to get the cars out. That's step one. So my assistant's gonna go over and she's going to go ahead and press the button on the wall and it start moving it down.
We're gonna have someone else, one of our helpers, go ahead and push the button on the wall, and that's gonna help us open and close the door. So when she presses it, the motor's gonna come forward. We always wanna have someone by the motor on the wall in case there's a problem or something goes wrong. She can press the button and tell the motor to stop for safety.
Does that make sense? So you don't just press the button and watch it happens, because it could come down and hurt your door. You want the person who's at the wall to stay at the wall. Now I'm going to go over here to the door, and I'm going to get ready to help lift this door, and I'm going to have Karen go ahead and press the button. So let's go ahead and press the button on the wall, and if I scream, you stop. Help lift this door up so that we can move it up and out of the way. So now the door is up. It's being held up by the operator. You have one spring that's kind of holding it in place, so it's okay to go ahead and get the vehicles out of the garage so you can start doing the work. And that's what we're going to do now. And one other thing, it's also a good idea to have a vice grip and clamp it to the rail on one side of the door. So if we had a vice grip right here, I would clamp it right here to the door so that if the opener let go or it came down, it would go ahead and not damage the door. The door would not come down. Okay, so the next thing we'll do is we'll take the cards out of the garage. Okay, so we have the door up and we've moved the cards out of the garage. And really, they just have to clear the garage, so they don't have to go all the way back into the street, because all we're going to be doing is working on the inside of the garage. Okay, the next step is whenever we're winding the springs up or working on the springs, the door has to be down. When the door comes down, it's going to put the spring into its maximum force position. So the spring's going to be tight. Remember, we have two springs up there. Each one is set for lifting approximately 80 pounds of weight for these types of springs on this size door. And if I was to come over here by mistake and pull this rope and have the opener let go, there's a good chance that the door could make its way and just fall to the ground at 80 pounds hitting the ground. If you have a single spring system and it's broke, and you go ahead and pull this rope while the door's up, that 160 pound door is going to slam to the ground. Now, if someone's in the way, that's going to be a big problem, but there's also a good chance it's going to damage your door when it hits the ground. So we've seen crumpled doors and things like this. So what we need to do is get the door down safely. And the way to do that, again, is have the motor help you do the job. Now that can be a little tricky, but it doesn't have to be. So what we're going to do is I'm going to help the motor, and I have to be cautious when I'm doing this, because if it does go out of control or the other spring breaks, then the whole full way of the door is going to come down. You can hurt your back, you can get physically hurt. So this is actually kind of a dangerous part. The other thing that's going to happen is the opener is going to help me down, but if I make the mistake of putting my feet in front of the photo eye, the opener is going to think something's in the way and it's going to go back up. So I have to stay clear of the photo eyes as I bring this door down. Okay? So I'm going to have my assistant press the button on the wall and the door is going to start to come down now. I make sure everything's clear and it's okay for the door to come down, and we're going to bring the door down. So please press the button for me. So the door starts to come down. I'm here to watch it, to secure it. I do not want to get my feet away, and I want to make sure everything stays even. The door goes down. Now the door goes down. In this case, the door went down and it wanted to go back up, right? Because maybe my feet got in the way, maybe my hand got in the way. So look, the opener went down and started to raise the door up again, but there's so much weight on the door, it's pulling the door away from the wall one more time. So I'm done using the opener, the door is down, everything's safe down here, so I'm going to release this opener and watch this pressure as the door comes down. I pull it back and it releases. This door here is around 4 and a half years old, and one of the springs is broken. And what makes a spring break 5 years, 10 years, 3 years is really the amount of times we open and close the door. And in this situation, this door opens and closes probably 10 times a day. So if it's rated for 10,000 cycles and we open it 10 times a day, you know, it really kind of, that's about 3,000 a year, and at least about 3 or 4 years. Sometimes you get longer. One of the things that you can do to increase the amount of times your garage door is able to last, or the cycle time we call it, the number of times the door opens and closes, is by changing out the springs with springs that are a little bit bigger and a little bit longer. And they're heavier duty, and it's longer steel, and it bends less. And it's kind of hard to explain. It's not important. The deal is you can buy springs that have extended duty. They last longer. So they can be identified by, in this case, the spring has the same width as the spring that's up here now. The steel that we have here is thicker than the steel that's on this door. This is a 0.207 gauge. This is 0.218, so it's a thicker steel. But you can't just put a thicker steel door with the same length, because it's going to be too strong for this weight of door. But in this case, by taking a thicker steel and extending the spring out longer, then, and you'll notice that this is a substantially longer spring than the one that was there before. So because it's longer, it doesn't lift as much, but it's thicker steel, so it balances it. This spring has been calculated specifically by us to give us more about 30,000 cycles of use before it is sort of scheduled to break. So because I don't want to redo the springs every couple of years or every 5 years or every 10 years, I'm going to try and get more length. I've opted to put these larger springs in the door. So that's what we're going to do here. Good? So it takes probably about 45 minutes to do this. And to replace a spring in your door, it's, you know, the theory is it's a dangerous thing to do. Well, if you know what you're doing, it's not so bad. But if you don't know what you're doing, it is a dangerous thing to do. We still have a hot spring up there. That thing is fully wound and it's ready and is able to generate enough force to lift up half of a 160-pound door. So it's ready to push. So by using the right tools and doing the right things, I can ensure that it can be done in a safe and efficient manner. If you do not know what you're doing, do not touch the door. This has red, the screws on this thing have red bolts on them. That signifies to you, the user, that loosening these things cause a lot of pressure. And there's a bunch of red bolts on this door. There's two on the springs right here. There's some red bolts over here. If I look here on these drums on the side, this has tension too. So red bolts are generally not to be touched by the homeowner unless they're very sure about what they're doing. So, you know, Cedar Park overhead doors, we do this all the time. It takes about 45 minutes. We'll get in there, get you fixed, and get you back on the road. So we'll be back. I'll talk to you when this thing is done. We'll see how it works out. All right, so it's been about 45 minutes to an hour now. We've got in the garage. We've taken the entire torsion tube assembly down, and we replaced the broken spring with a brand new spring over here. The old springs are down. And in this case, we've decided to replace two springs while we were doing it. And the reason is regardless whether you're placing one or two, you have to take the whole bar down. So there's a lot of labor and time that goes into it. And since springs are usually made in batches and they're usually made pretty close together and they usually go up together at the same time, when one spring breaks, the one that hasn't broken is running the same number of cycles, doing the same amount of work, and there's a good chance that that spring could break relatively quick. In my experience, I would say typically it's within 2 weeks to 6 months is when the second spring breaks if you opt to replace only one spring. So what that would mean is we come out, we replace one spring, we charge a certain amount of money, we charge the labor, then 6 months later the other spring breaks, we come out and we have to take the whole thing down, we charge the same labor, and we charge it for the other spring. Most people, and in my mind, it's the best idea is replace both springs at the same time, they're together, they're matched, it's the right way to go. And it'll probably save you money in the long run. So replacing both springs is definitely the preferred option, unless you have a single spring system. And that brings to mind another thing. Sometimes when manufacturers build doors, it's possible to have a single spring. One large spring sits here, and either goes this way or that way. But instead of having two separate springs like we see here, we have one large spring. It costs less for the manufacturer to do that, but what's the difference? What's the advantage of each one? Well, it's a disadvantage to have a single spring system for a couple of reasons. And they are, when a single spring system works, then it is broken, there's no tension on the door, and the entire weight of the door is automatically on the door. Second thing that happens is when there's no tension on the spring, the cables on the end and the drum backs up, the cables fall out of the drums, the cables come out, and there's nothing controlling the door. So if a spring breaks and the door is up, when the opener brings it down, there's a good chance that it's going to come down crooked or damaged, or the opener is going to break free at this connection right here and the door is going to slam to the ground. So a single spring system is substandard for a couple of reasons. And there's a third reason, actually. Another reason is that typically a single spring system does not have the cycle rating that a double spring system has. So for a quick calculation of our software, we would see that a single spring system is typically good for around 13,000 open and closing cycles. Whereas the dual system, the standard dual system that we put up there typically, is going to be good for 20,000 cycles. So you get another 30 to 40% of number of cycles on a dual spring system. So it's safer. It's a better system, it's easier to replace, and it has more life cycle time. Okay, so those are the reasons that we prefer to put up a dual system. And at Cedar Park Overhead Doors, when we put in a large door, 16-foot door, we'll ask for a two-spring system. We'll put in a two-spring system on your house. So now, we've put the new spring in, I've connected everything up, it's there, now I want to test it. And, you know, of course it's going to work with the motor, because the motor is going to work, it's going to do a lot of lifting, but I'm going to release the motor from the situation, and I'm going to lift it with my hand. So when I lift this door, it's probably 5 or 6 pounds off the floor, and the door stops in the middle. That's a balanced door. That's what it's supposed to do. Now when I come a little higher, the door comes up, it still stays where it's supposed to stay. You bring the door up all the way, the door comes up into the opening, it's up in the opening, the cables are tight, it's out of the way of the door. So this thing is in pretty good situation. You know, if I was to take a little bit closer look here, push that right out of here, the door starts to get a little hot. It wants to come up a little bit. Well, on a brand new door spring installation, the springs are going to be a little stiff. The springs will typically settle a little bit as time goes by, within the first couple of weeks or first couple of months. So we actually like them just a little bit hot and then hit it, and then they'll settle in for you. But these springs, since we went with the longer spring, since we went with a higher gain spring and a longer spring, this should be a 30,000 cycle system. We shouldn't have to replace these springs for another 10 or 15 years based on the amount of times we open and close the door, of course. And we happen to use our garage door as a front door every day, so it gets a lot of use. So there you go. This is how this is introduction to springs and broken springs and what happens and what it takes to fix them. If you have any questions or any problems, give us a call, Cedar Park Overhead Doors, 335-7441. And nowadays, it's 512-335-7441. Let us open your door to a great day. Thanks.